This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to the pre-dawn gloriousness that is the African bush. We're on the fresh tracks of lions. This is Safari Live.
Ready.
Standing by.
Welcome to the Sabi Sands Game Reserve, South Africa, for your very own live African safari. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Dangerous Dave the Dish on camera with me today. And thank you to all of those who sent updates from the Juma Dam cam about the lions heading south on Twin Dams. Their tracks are here. We're on them. Hopefully they haven't wandered too far and we'll see them shortly. Now, of course, apart from being live, we are interactive. Hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, questions at wildearth.tv via email. And I didn't hear the lions early this morning, so I'm hoping that they haven't gone too far. And there's a nice big herd of impalas. Have you seen any lions, impalas? No zebras? It's about 22 degrees Celsius, 72 Fahrenheit. It's a wonderful warm morning, and I'm hoping summer has finally arrived. None of this cold nonsense in October. Okay, I've lost their tracks. Let me just have a quick look. It could have been obliterated by the zebra. No, they're still here. Still heading south, hopefully not too far south. Hopefully they decided Chele Plan was a good place to recline and fight over mating rights. So I hear that they were mating two males there. Could be really exciting. There could be some competition. There could be some slapping. Male lions can get very aggressive with each other, even if they're in the same coalition when it comes to mating. All the little impalas spent their evening avoiding the big cats, and actually their days too. They pretty much do the opposite to what we do. We try look for big cats, they try avoid them. So while Dangerous Dave the Dish and myself keep on these tracks, let's go across to Jamie and Viam so they can bid you a fond good morning.
Good morning and welcome on the Sunrise Safari. My name is Jamie and this morning I have Viam on camera with me. And whilst Brent follows up on those lions, I'm going to be checking all of the boundaries of Juma to see whether or not any of the spotted cats have decided to return. Ah, there's Brent chatting on the Game Drive channel. Now that's our plan for this morning's drive. Going to see whether or not, since we haven't seen Tingana in ages, we haven't seen Shadow in ages, we're just going to give a thorough check to all the boundaries, and maybe even Queen Karula has decided to come back north after she crossed south yesterday on the Sunset Safari. Our spring is most definitely in the air. It is predicted to go over 40 degrees this afternoon, so October back to its rightful temperatures. We've started out on a mild 22 degrees centigrade, so 72 Fahrenheit. It's a nice warm morning here in the African bush. As I said, spring is in the air. I've just seen a cuckoo shoot past me, accompanied by a drongo in hot pursuit. For those of you unfamiliar with our birds of this area, cuckoos obviously, as you know, are brood parasites, which means they lay eggs in other birds' nests. And this particular one was a greater spotted cuckoo that shot past, which does target drongos, and drongos don't take it lying down. They are, for their size, seriously aggressive little birds, and they do fight back. and this one was mobbing the cuckoo to try and get it away from its nest so that it doesn't have to invest energy in raising another bird's chicks. And there's all sorts of approaches that the birds adopt. One is to imitate the calls of cuckoos so that the cuckoos think that that spot is taken. And then one, of course, is to vigorously fight back, vigorously attack the marauding cuckoos, make sure that they don't come in. So interesting approaches. And speaking of birds, of course, I've just seen a lilac-breasted roller fly by. We need to find a broad-billed roller this morning. I'm very jealous of Brent's sighting of the broad-billed roller. I'm hoping that we can find one as well. Forgot to ask him where it was. But until then, we can occupy ourselves with something much, much larger. An animal that has been living around our camp at the moment. Hello, Edlees. What a nice way to start a morning. I'm trying to find a good place to settle us. Looks like a large herd. Of course, as soon as we see elephants at the moment, the first thing we start thinking of is this the same herd that has the tiny little one in it? Let's just stop here for the moment and have a look. It's a large herd. Hello. Lots and lots of elephants in this group. I can see at least, I'd say at least 12, probably more. It's a big female wrapping her trunk around the acacia trees. Now on this particular seepline that we're on at the moment, there's plenty of underground water, but there's also lots and lots of silver cluster leaves, which is not really yummy food for an elephant, which means they have to pick and choose their breakfast carefully, just like this little one was doing. There you go, that's the silver cluster leaf. Not very nice at all. Those of you who are regular viewers will know we've often eaten the leaves and pulled funny faces because it's very, very high in tannins. It's unusual for the elephants to target them unless they are really desperate. You can see they've found themselves little spots around the silver cluster leaf trees and quite happily munching away. What a special way to start off our sunrise safari. If this is your first time experiencing these amazing animals, they truly are one of our absolute favorites to sit and watch. There's always something happening in an elephant herd, whether it's babies playing or just watching the amazing way that they go about their day-to-day business, the way that they feed, wrapping their trunk around the leaves. They're just complex and fascinating. And there's nothing in the animal kingdom quite like a trunk. It is so unique in the way that it functions. No bones, just muscles, and an incredible diversity of actions that it can be used to execute. Which elephant herd have we got here? I'm trying to work it out. We've become so familiar with the different elephant fly. Flaff. Flaff, flaff, flaff. In my mouth. Summer's back. Yummy. We've become so familiar with the different elephant herds that move about our traverse area, particularly on Juma. Of course, an elephant herd can cover an enormous amount of distance and they are not territorial. So we've got to be careful of making an assumption that we've seen these elephants before, but we probably have. There have been lots and lots of elephants around Juma. I think we spoke about it yesterday, but probably because this is one of the few green places in the Sabi Sand. So there's still food for them. But they do seem, because there are so many of them, as I mentioned earlier, there's so many of them at the moment that they are spending a great deal of time around the camps. And they don't seem to be wanting to take no for an answer. A closed gate in an elephant's mind doesn't really make for much of an obstacle. And they've smashed through quite a few over the last few days, just gently pushing it aside. I mean, an elephant is capable of pushing over a massive tree, pushing over a gate is really of no consequence to them. And of course, camps tend to have between sort of the odd leaking, just a gentle leaking pipe, they tend to have lots. Oh, look at over the trunk up. sniffing the air. Hello, big girl. Love your ear. It's a very stylish neck. What have you found? Here you go. That's the neck I was talking about. And then she stopped immediately and swung round. It's amazing their sense of smell. You can actually, if you watch really closely, you can see it influencing their every move. As she walked past there, her trunk was up to her face. It was in line with her forehead. And then all of a sudden she stopped and she swung around, shifting her weight back onto her right side, and immediately tackled the tiniest of baby acacias at the base of the silver cluster leaf. Makes you wonder, I've spoken about this before, but how incredible it would be to just spend a day in the life of an elephant's head. There's lots of elephants coming through, actually. I can see plenty of them moving about. This could be our herd. I'm so hopeful. I'm really hoping this is our herd with a little one. We're looking for Fang, of course. I was talking about the fact that we sort of identify regular visitors to Juma. Ellie, an appropriate name for the animal that we're dealing with. Ellie would like to know if elephants have regular migratory routes that they can utilize. And the answer is yes, they used to have. It's actually quite a sad thing. In areas, sort of in parts of Africa where there are massive, massive conservation areas, they can still utilize regular ancient migratory routes. But elephants would have covered enormous distances at a time before human beings came and imposed themselves and their civilization. And of course, as a result, their protected areas. Not that there's anything wrong with a protected area, but it is by its very nature, it has to be fenced off to stop them from interacting with the communities around them. So yes, they would have had ancient migratory routes through to where the best food would be, in times of drought perhaps, in times of plenty. And of course that option isn't really available to them. Luckily the elephants of this area at least have a massive 4 million hectare reserve in which to walk around. They can go towards Mozambique, although it would at times be preferable if they didn't, and they can go up towards Zimbabwe, right through the top northeastern corner of this beautiful country. There are plans though. I mean, they are plans that will be a long time in the making, if indeed they ever actually surface, but I would love to believe they would, to buy up and to get people to buy into a scheme that would essentially drop fences all across the country and open up ancient migratory corridors that would allow the elephants to move as they, if not exactly how they used to, at least give them the option of moving far into the west of the country and back again. So it's the Greater Blue Canyon Nature Reserve to extend all the way west to Mapungubwe, which is a reserve that borders Botswana and Zimbabwe. Whether or not that ever comes into practice, well, you can just imagine the logistics behind it. Trying to keep them safe, trying to convince people that it would be worthwhile giving up their farmland in order to provide that option. Running the risk of having elephants move into their crops. Giving up grazing land. In a country like South Africa with such complicated politics and socio-economic conditions, it's a brave and valiant idea. I would love to see it work in progress. Imagine if these beautiful animals could roam as far as they want to. An elephant herd can walk easily 20 kilometers in one day, if not more. Those massive legs covering immense distances. The one thing that we can say with absolute certainty, and this is for Chai Connie, you wanted to know if the elephants in this area are hunted at all. No, they are absolutely not. So fortunately, we're lucky in South Africa in that we don't have a massive problem with elephant poaching in the same way that other countries do further north into Africa. For now, our elephants are relatively safe, and it's an unusual thing for an elephant to be poached. It does happen, don't get me wrong. Sometimes they fall victim as well to poisoned water holes, which is always tragic. But for the most part, these elephants are safe. And then in terms of legal hunting, no. There is no way on earth that legal hunting is allowed in the Sabi Sand. These elephants are not trophy hunted in any way. There are places in South Africa where it does happen, and there are places throughout Africa where it does happen, but not here. It's a mystery to me. Totally unfathomable. But it does happen, but not here. Which is why I always enjoy sitting and watching these elephants, particularly, for example, a situation like with that newborn elephant that we saw a couple of days ago. Just incredibly comforting to see them. Knowing that their lives will be, for the most part, unless something terrible happens, their lives will be completely safe. And you, little boy? You on the outskirts already. Little male bringing up the rear. And Tyler, with absolute pleasure, you are a new viewer and I'd like to bid you the warmest of welcomes to our live safari. You wanted to know the elephant's ages that we are viewing. So this little boy, I would put him at, I'm guessing, maybe around 8-9 years old. He could be a little bit younger, but you can see his tusks have already started to develop. And the fact that his behavior is putting him on the outskirts of the herd already suggests that sexual maturity or teenagehood is not too far around the corner. So there we go. To give you the ages of all of the elephants is going to be a tricky one. There's quite a few. Most of these females, you'll have a mix of anywhere from newborn calves right up into the elephant cows that can be 20, 30, 40 years old. So one of the ways that you can age an elephant, Tyler, and it's difficult, you won't be able to do it accurately at all without looking at their teeth any more than I can do it 100% accurately. But one of the ways is to look at the temporal region of an elephant, where between their eyes and their ears, the top of their skull, you can see the bones sort of start to sink in around that region. There's a dent there, sort of a hand-sized dent or a couple of dents. And that gets deeper and more pronounced as an elephant ages. That being said, of course, you can't always judge it that way because sometimes they lose condition, especially in a drought where they've lost their subcutaneous fat. It might be a little bit more tricky to tell because their bones become more prominent. But the older an elephant gets, the more prominent those bones become. Remember, an elephant can live up to 60 years in the wild, but you're probably looking at between 45 to 60 in terms of life expectancy. And they are beautiful animals. I'll see, Tyler, if I can get you another example, perhaps when they are starting to move towards a really nice open area, which is what I'm hoping will happen. I don't want to reposition just yet. I want to try and get ahead of the herd and go and see if it is the one with our little baby. Quite a few youngsters. What am I missing? Anne in California has asked about a white blooming plant around the elephants and would like to know what it is. Anne? I'm looking for you. I'm not 100% sure, unless it's the silver cluster leaves that are looking a little bit white. Perhaps it looks like they're blooming. Yes, I think that might be what you're looking at. So that's actually the leaves of the silver cluster leaf. Sorry, correct me if I'm wrong, Anne. Maybe I'm looking at the wrong thing. If you spotted something else, I'm open to that. But I think it's the silver cluster leaves that you're looking at. And that's actually what gives the silver cluster leaf their name. Particularly for young plants, they have these shiny silvery hairs on the bottom that seem to be in this morning light. They seem to be glowing quite white. And I will try, obviously when there's not an entire herd of elephants in front of me, because I don't think they'd take very kindly to my sudden emergence from the vehicle, I will try and pluck some for you and show you just how silvery those leaves truly are. I think that's what you're seeing through the eyes of the camera. Correct me if I'm wrong though. There we go. See how silvery it is? Particularly in this morning light. That's what I was talking about with the silver cluster leaf. Taking on a little bit of a shine. And then, actually, yes, if I do look, it does almost feel as though the silver cluster leaves are blooming, but it's just them getting their spring leaves. Look, it all looks so white. It does look like white flowers. I'm just listening. I can hear ground hornbills. It's the second morning that I've heard them calling from this area. I'm sure it's that same pair that we saw on Buffel's hook cut line not too long ago. For our new viewers, a ground hornbill is an amazing bird, massive, the size of a turkey, roughly, give or take, and incredibly endangered. I am going to go around, I think, and try and get to the front of this elephant herd as they make their way in that direction. So until I do that, let's head across to Brent and get an update on how his lion search is going.
So there's one thing better than lion tracks. It's lion audio to follow. And I heard it sounded like a male lion calling in this vicinity. So we rushed here. And I'm just making sure that it's not east of our traverse area. So we're gonna move along here, checking, making sure no tracks cross. And then we'll probably loop back down along Drakensberg Road, seeing if we can find him. I'm really hoping, I think he's either right on the boundary or just inside Juma from what I heard. But if he's on the move, he could have crossed into Torchwood. Good news. No tracks crossing. Now, there's just one of those quintessential African sounds, the roar of a male lion. Big Safari Live welcome to Hey! Hey Hey, who's a new viewer. And Hey would like to know, what country are we in? We are in the beautiful South Africa. And more specifically, we are in the northeastern area of South Africa. Our province is called Mpumalanga, which means where the sun rises. So we're right on the east. We're in the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park, which is made up of reserves over three countries and is about 8.5 million hectares. And we are on the western sections of that reserve at the moment on a place called Juma Private Game Reserve, which falls within the Sabi Sands Game Reserve. And to the east of us is Kruger National Park. And if you see me looking over the side like this, hey, I'm looking for tracks of the lions. So I said, we're in the Kruger National Park, and it is wonderful. We're in early summer. We've had a little bit of rain so far. Now, you guys want to be walking away from where a lion's calling. Yeah, it looks like there's actually a herd of buffalo here. Ooh, exciting. Some buffalo. Now the lions at the moment are really feasting on buffalo. Chai Connie's wondering, how long since the incredible Nkulumas made a kill? Well, they left a kill yesterday, a buffalo kill. So I don't know if they killed last night. It's always possible. Rexon said he heard some pandemonium to the north of Gallagher camp last night. So he's going to check in that area. Sounded like some animal in distress being chased by rions. So we've got no tracks just yet. Of lions, of course. There's lots of tracks of other animals. So there's the rest of the buffalo herd coming up. Now I know this is a little phrase I've used a few times, but the sound of a buffalo herd blowing is literally like to a lion, like an ice cream truck going down the road is to a small child. Oof, looks like quite a big herd. Quite spread out. Still no sign of the lion. Hello, buffaloes. And you can see how skinny they are. And we are coming out of the worst drought in recorded history in South Africa. And makes the buffaloes quite easy for the lions to catch. Keep going because I'm worried about that lion being very close to the boundary and moving, so we're going to just keep checking. Now yesterday Jamie and I both saw a lone female buffalo. I'm not sure whether it's the same one, and Peter's wondering, could she join a new herd or must she find her parent herd? No, she's easily capable of joining a new herd. Now there isn't really infighting amongst the females so much to be in the herd as with the males. But with that particular buffalo, just the way she was behaving, I think she has a botfly infestation. So what happens is the maggots or the larvae of that botfly generally go in through the nostrils and get right into the sinuses. And just from the behavior she was displaying, they've probably eaten through her optic nerve. So she can't really see anything at the moment. So I think in that case, it's going to be very difficult for her to join any herd. And that's probably why she charged Andrew. Now I was chatting to the head ecologist of the Sabi Sands, and he says to the south they've been finding a lot of buffalo with those botfly infestations. Now it's not that uncommon. Generally during droughts and stuff, things like that become worse. But one of the very much telltale signs of an optic nerve damage by botflies is walking in circles. And I believe it was doing that with Jamie yesterday. Now, impala actually even walk in the tightest circle when they get botfly that have chewed through their optic nerves. Very interesting stuff. Not so pleasant if you're a buffalo. So, we've seen buffalo, we've seen elephants. Now we're looking for lions, but while we do that, let's go back to some more elephants with Jamie.
In this case, a tiny little baby elephant. For Taylor and new viewers, this little one is probably only a couple of days old. Still a little wobbly, not as young as the one that we saw a couple of days ago. But still a very, very tiny little one. Hello, mommy. Oh, it's okay. You can see her putting herself between us and it. Hello, big girl. I'm not gonna hurt you, don't worry. Don't worry. Your baby is beautiful. Your baby is very beautiful. Yes, you're beautiful too, little girl. It's okay. It's okay. And this elephant herd very much on the move due to the presence of one large bull at the back who's pressuring them. There's little one. We might have to make a strategic retreat at some point as he makes his way towards us. He is absolutely massive, and here he comes to cause nonsense. There he is. He's at the all little ones moving away. Okay, we're not going anywhere now. We're going to sit tight. Hello, little baby. Welcome to the world. It's a little girl. I think this might be the little girl that Brent saw. I'm losing track. There's so many new elephants. Oh, so many obstacles with little feeties. Aha, hello. Yes, little one. Don't you come to cause nonsense. Don't you come cause nonsense. Hello, my boy. Hello, my boy. Are you harassing the ladies? You're not a boy. You are a very, very big girl. Well, there's the matriarch, without any question. The way that she's pushing and guiding the rest of the elephants. Jeeps, she's huge. She towers above all of them. Oh, goodness gracious, so many elephants to look at. All coming past the vehicle, and there's nothing quite like this experience. It's so special being surrounded by these absolute giants of the African bush. And yes, you kind of need to have eyes in the back of your head to make sure that nobody's going to come and cause any nonsense. So my mistake, I thought they were being harassed by a bull. That's how big that female was. Turns out she's just the matriarch chivvying them along, getting everybody to move. I think they're on their way to Galago Pan for a drink. And they're not really stopping to feed, just constant movement. Hello, girl. There must be about 30 elephants in this herd. Our faith? Not a silly question at all. It's a very, very good question. And please don't worry about asking silly questions. There's very few of them. I can name a few, but that wasn't a silly question. I've had a few silly questions. That wasn't one of them. Our faith would like to know, because it's a full moon tonight, does it change the animal's behavior in any way? Yes, it absolutely does. Generally, the diurnal animals, like these elephants, are more active at night. And elephants are always relatively active. They tend to feed. They might not cover such large distances as they might otherwise on an ordinary evening without that much ambient light. But on a full moon night, it's almost as light as if it is during the day, and they can move throughout the evening. Wild dogs often hunt at night. Cheetah can often hunt at night in a full moon night. The birds chirp away quite merrily all the way through the night. I was listening to them. I don't know if any of you were listening on the dam camera. The sand grouse. I mean, sand grouse, what are they doing up in the middle of the night? They were merrily flying overhead last night and singing away. So yes, it does affect the animal's behavior. Makes hunting for predators a lot more tricky because, of course, they don't have the cloak of darkness to hide themselves. The lions, unless it was a cloudy evening, or unless it is going to be a cloudy evening, the lions and the leopards are going to struggle to sneak up in the way they might usually, and you'll find that the animal herds will go to nice open clearings and nothing can actually sneak up on them without being spotted. So it does absolutely impact the behavior of the animals. And the humans as well. I mean, we can go and sit out in a night surrounded by elephants and just listen and watch them. It's one of my favorite things to do on a full moon night. Because you can see all that's going on around you. You don't need lights. You can safely sit and just absorb the atmosphere of elephants feeding around you. It's very special. I love doing it. One of my absolute favorite things to do. And of course, I said this yesterday. My perception of the full moon has changed. Those of you, if you wouldn't mind sparing a thought for the anti-poaching teams around Africa, that, because of course, full moon is poacher's moon. It makes life a heck of a lot easier to be able to see when you're moving through the bush at night. So spare a thought for the anti-poaching teams that are going to be working extra specially hard to protect the animals, not just in the Sabi Sand, but around South Africa and around Africa as the full moon comes up. It's a shame that something so magical has been tainted by that impression. Eddie, speaking about poaching and the problem that various African countries have, you want to know if elephant tusks are anywhere near as valuable as rhino horn. And yes, they are. They are almost as valuable as rhino horn. A rhino horn, it's two different substances, so it's difficult to compare value. And of course, it depends on the tusks that you're talking about and whether or not they're suitable in terms of size for carving things like ivory statues and so on. Gives me the shivers just thinking about it. Rhino horn is worth more than twice its weight in gold, but it is quite a light-ish substance in that it is made of keratin rather than dentine rather than ivory. Tusks, of course, are a different thing. They are modified teeth rather than basically a fingernail growing from the top of the rhino's nose, which makes the whole process more absurd. So they're very close to being as valuable as rhino horn. I'm not sure what the black market value is right now. It's sort of It shifts and goes up and down as markets do, but particularly in a black market, of course, the prices are not stable. But at least with ivory, there is some in a legal market which drops it. It's complex, I know, and I'm not going to go into the full economics of it. Firstly, because I don't fully understand the full economics of it. And secondly, it's a long conversation. But essentially, because there's some legal ivory in the market, it has dropped the price ever so slightly. I know the issues in terms of making it easier to get into the black market. I'm just talking about pure economics here. And then the rhino horn, of course, there is absolutely no legal trade in rhino horn, whether it's old rhino horn or new rhino horn. And as a result, the value is automatically higher because they've got to find ways to get it into the countries where there is a demand for it. So it's just it's a very interesting dynamic. And here in South Africa, we have a bigger problem with rhino poaching than we do with elephant poaching. But when the rhinos are gone, the elephants will be next. Not when, if the rhinos were gone, but they're not going to be, because that's a war we will win. South Africa's brought rhinos back from the brink before, and we'll do it again. Aubrey.
Yeah, morning, Jeremy. Go ahead.
Morning, Orbs. Can I come and join you with those Ngala?
Maybe I'm not sure. Maybe you're gonna get a visual from the channel. They come out on the eastern side. Yeah, you're welcome. The inside pivots of Lala Pans is of the dam.
Copy that. Thanks, Aubrey. I'll try. I'll give it a go. Okay. Interestingly enough, Aubrey has, thanks to Brent, by the way, for sending us through that update, because I wasn't really listening. I was concentrating on elephants. Interestingly enough, Aubrey's managed to locate the lions on Buffalo's Hook. I'm not sure if that's the rest of the Nkuhuma Pride or if it's the ones that were seen on the dam camera this morning. If it was the ones that were seen on the dam camera, they've pulled a very sneaky maneuver. Let's go up in that direction, since our elephants have all but disappeared. They're on their way to Galagopan to have a drink, possibly to the DRC, to push more trees into the road. So we'll start heading across in that direction. What a lovely way to start a morning, though. And nice to know that the elephants that you're looking at are protected and safe from the issues that we've been talking about. Okay, what's going to be our quickest route? I have a feeling we're going to encounter an elephant roadblock if we go that way. Okay. Well, let's meander slowly. For now, the lions are lying down. They're north of our traverse area. I'm going to meander in that direction rather than racing off. And while I do, let's head across to Brent so that he can update you on his plans.
So unfortunately, those lions calling are definitely inside Torchwood. So maybe they'll follow that buffalo herd, but I think they're quite far away from them. I just heard them roaring again now recently. So Dangerous Dave and myself have decided, let's go do a spin around the Cheetah Plains, see if there's anything down that side. Maybe we'll get lucky with the quarantine male leopard. Maybe there'll be an ostrich. Maybe there'll actually be a cheetah. I haven't seen cheetah in so long, but definitely worth. I don't think we've been down there for a while, so nice morning. Let's go have a squiz. Now, before we hi, Gorvin. Gorvin would like to know, are we going to see any African antelope today? Well, Gorvin, we've already passed a few impala, which are, of course, an African antelope. I'm going to see if we can find some for you shortly. Let's have a look. Dave, where are the antelope? They're gone. There's an antelope, Dave. Gorvin, just for you, as you requested, an African antelope, an impala. Of course, it's not an impala, it is just an impala. Now, they are the most numerous antelope in Africa. They are one of the most adaptable of the antelope species. They are the great generalist, and they are able to fill a lot of ecological niches and by being both grazers and browsers. So they eat both grass and leaves. And they occur from semi-desert to the edge of forest. But their preferred terrain is a savanna, which we're in at the moment. A particular type of savanna we're in is what you'd call broad-leafed woodland. Crests dominated by bush willows, combretons, marullas and knobthorns, and then interspersed with little dry river systems where you find our big evergreen trees, scotias, jackalberries, saffrons and other wonderful such things. And on the seep lines is where you find a lot of the grazing species, and there you will find terminalias or cluster leaves. A very diverse system. But hopefully we'll be able to find you some antelope a little bit closer to us as we continue our endeavours to the east. Now, we've left Juma Private Game Reserve and we're heading to Cheetah Plains Private Game Reserve. Now, both of these fall within the Sabi Sands, but I do see something right next to the road. Probably a much better view of the African antelope you requested. And the males of the impala have horns, and the females don't. There we go. There's, oh, young male running away. There we go, we can see a male off to the right. It's a young male. He hasn't developed big horns yet. He's one of last year's babies. They are such dainty looking antelope, incredibly quick and incredibly agile, and they can jump sort of 7 meters vertically. But we're about to go through a big dip where unfortunately we are out of signal range, but I'll be through it quick sticks and be back with you hopefully when I'm on Cheetah Plains. In the meantime, let's go see how Jamie's search for the lions is going.
Well, I haven't found the lions just yet. I haven't had time to get all the way to the lions, but I have encountered some of their favorite food. In this case, a massive herd of buffalo. And I just want to reposition because I want to show you the biggest female buffalo I think I've seen in a very long time. She's absolutely massive. Hopefully she lets us come around this side. I mean, this female is a female, definitely a female. She's nearly the size, she's bigger than some of the bulls in this herd. She's absolutely huge. That is one impressive female buffalo. It's a pity I can't get her compared to, there's a female at the back sort of to give you a comparison, just in terms of the height of this buffalo. She's so tall. She's about the size of a Dugger boy. Not quite the full mass, but almost. Wow, I'm suitably impressed. That is one of the, that actually might be one of the biggest female buffalo that I have seen ever. She's huge. It's difficult to give you a sense of scale though, I understand that. Just suffice to say she's almost the size of a male and she's bigger than some of the young males here. I'm not sure how large this herd is. It sounds to be relatively big. And we've been seeing lots and lots of them. I think I must have gone for at least 2 months without seeing a breeding herd of buffalo. And now we see almost two every single drive, at least. And they're like the elephants, moving into these areas to try and find themselves some green grass. Here's a young one in good condition. This herd doesn't look too bad. That big female we were looking at isn't looking great, but most of them are in relatively good condition. Wow. That cow looks... Is she pregnant? I think she is. She does look saggy, doesn't she? She does look pregnant. Buffalo can breed at any time of the year, but there is a peak season in the rainy season itself, which makes total sense for all of the herbivores. You know, when do you want to have your babies? Well, you want to have your babies when there's resources available to feed yourself and sustain yourself and make sure that you've got enough resources to feed the little one. So it makes total sense to have a peak season and a peak survival rate around the rainy season, but the rainy season hasn't really started yet. She might have a month or so to go. Here's a big male. I say biggish, he's actually quite a young male. It's just his skin conditions make him look older than he might otherwise. You can see the slight balding patches. That's very common with all buffalo. Hello, big boy. Balding patches, either through mange or through fungal infections. Get a variety of different skin diseases. I wonder if the lions know that they're here, and I wonder if those lions managed to catch anything. We're going to have to head across in that direction to see whether or not they are looking full. Aha! Good question from Murali. One really confused Dacre. Disturbed by the which way are we gonna go? Oh dear. Oh shame. Whole herd of buffalo have just obviously disturbed it, and now it's gotta try and bob and weave between them. As short sighted animals, something small moving in their midst might cause an unexpectedly aggressive reaction, so that poor little Dacre's got to tread lightly. Sweet man. Right, Murali, let's find you a good example. A good question. You'll do. If you don't mind, madam. Can we just sit and look at your horns for a moment? Murali would like to know, why is it female water buffalo have a boss, whilst female antelope don't even have horns? That's a good question. First of all, just a subtle distinction, they are caper buffalo. They're not, they're no longer defined as water buffalo. We don't actually get water buffalo in this area. These are Cape buffalo, and they extend all the way from the Cape in South Africa right up through the Horn of Africa towards Eastern Africa. Not the Horn of Africa, sorry. All along the eastern side of Africa. So we get Cape buffalo, and then there's forest buffalo towards the western area of Africa, Gabon and so on. Why do they have a boss? Now, the boss refers to the base in the middle of the horns, where the horns meet, that solid patch of bone. In the males, it is far more developed than it is in the females. Okay, so horns are used for two things, defense and for mating advantages, to battle with other males. Those are the two reasons why any animal has horns. And just a slight something to note, some female antelope do have horns. So, for example, the gemsbok or the oryx, the females have long, straight, pointy horns, exactly the same as the male. Wildebeest, both the female and the male have horns. And wildebeest, despite their cow-like appearance, are in fact antelope. Now, the reason, the distinction seems to be, and if you look at the statistics and the sort of the correlation, if an animal lives in a sort of densely vegetated area, something like a Nyala perhaps, or impala, or kudu, horns for the females would be a disadvantage because they get stuck in the vegetation, and they basically, the antelope in question would hide rather than fight. The males keep their horns, though, because they need them to battle other males for females. If you've got an animal that lives out in the open, yes, hello, big girl, looking at us, yes, we're talking about your horns. If you've got an animal that lives out in the open, and it's very often bulk grazers, but not always, so, for example, a buffalo, or, let's say, an oryx, which will live in a more arid areas, roan, sable, all of those animals, the females have horns, because the females are actually far more likely to use them to fight back and defend their youngsters and themselves against predators, because they can't run and hide. They're big animals. They can't disappear in the same way kudu or nyala might. They have to stand and fight, and that's why the females have horns. There's a very strong correlation between habitat and behavior and whether or not the females of the species have horns. And of course, the distinction between horns and antlers, for those of you, because of course, here's a question for you. I'm asking for all of our viewers in different parts of the world. Which deer are there any deer that the females have antlers? Female reindeer have antlers, don't they? Yes, they do. Unless I'm very much mistaken. I'd be interested to see if there's that sort of correlation in other areas as well. Antlers, of course, are a different story because they can be shed. They can and are shed. And they are made from solidified blood vessels. And there we go. There's a question I'm asking all of you. I can think of reindeer. Reindeer have... I'm not wrong, am I? Female reindeer do have antlers. Or do grow antlers. I'm just curious to know whether or not there are any other species of deer. Yeah. Okay. And there's a kudu, but she's very, very hidden. She's on a termite mound. Speaking of female antelope that don't have horns, there's one such example. So in Africa, that's a very, very strict correlation between the two. Sometimes you get weird exception. Female dacre with horns, for example. That doesn't always happen. And they are an animal that relies on being stealthy more than anything else. It makes more sense for the females not to have horns, but sometimes they do just randomly grow horns, and not all females do. But everything out here exists for a purpose. Sable. Right, let's talk about turning the tables on predators. Buffalo do on a regular basis. I was actually sorting through some footage, and I found some amazing slow motion footage that we got the day that we saw the Nkuhumas kill a buffalo calf. And the poor female was desperately fighting to defend it, using her horns and her bulk and her strength to chase them away. Sable do it as well, as do roan and gemsbok. And it's quite extraordinary to watch. Gemsbok, the females, if they are attacked, can go down on their front wrists and then bend back onto their elbows, and they scythe from side to side with those massive spear-like horns. A truly incredible sight to witness. Gemsbok are one of my favorite antelope. I'm kind of sad we don't get them here, but it's not really the right conditions for them. Absolutely massive, with long, beautiful black and white markings and long spear-like horns on the tops of their heads, and very, very brave and very powerful creatures. Okay, buffalo, I think we should start making our way towards those lions. Might have to wait at the buffalo crossing, though. There we go. I thought that was the case. I remembered reading something about it. So thank you to Steph, who says Santa's reindeers were all female, since they don't shed their antlers in the same way that male reindeer do, presumably over the Christmas period, over the Christmas season. So there you go. Donna and Vixen were all well suitably named, or perhaps Rudolph not so much. Now I can't think of another reindeer name. Dasher and Comet, and I can't remember them. It's been a long time since I've thought about the names of Santa's reindeer. A very, very long time. And there we go, learning something new. I wonder what the South African equivalent would be. Nyala. Would Santa have Nyala pulling his sled? I like that idea. It's a very pretty thought. Or kudu. I mean, they've got to be something quite large. Mind you, they do fly, so we're not really putting physics into this whole description. I don't think buffalo would make very good reindeer. Or reindeer equivalents. It'd be slightly terrifying. Imagine 12 flying Duggar boys. You'd be at serious risk of buffalo patties falling from the sky. Moving on. use leopards instead. Are we going all out, flying leopards? That sounds terrifying. Imagine a kudu with a red nose. Now thoroughly entertained. Somebody artistic out there, please draw us a picture of the of what it would look like. The buffalo are looking at me like I'm completely bonkers, but that's how buffalo look at you always. James described it best, I think. He described it as, and you? Hi. What can I do for you? You know, I'd very much like to go and find out what those zebra are fighting about, mister. Hello, did I interrupt you mid-snack? Little boy, you are so cute. Well, this is the most curious I've ever had a buffalo be. Complete with leaf in mouth. Yes, I promise I'm not doing anything. I'm just sitting here. I have to tell you that you're not very intimidating with a leaf sticking out of your mouth. We're just going to have to wait for Buffalo Crossing to conclude. So while I sit here in the Monday, no, what day is it today? Sunday. So it's definitely not Sunday morning traffic. Well, I guess this is Sunday morning traffic. While I sit here in the Sunday morning traffic. I was going to say we'll go over to Brent, but we're not going anywhere. We're going to stick by here until Kirsty is able to get hold of him. Aha! And on that note, we're going to go across to Brent. She's managed to get hold of him. Let's see what Cheetah Plains is looking like.
I also some yari that's slowly making her way towards this area. Still in the Shatin. Gala's
boogering
towards that side.
I think I'm out of comms range. I'm not hearing anything.
Whoopsie daisy, and as you can tell, poor Brent didn't have any comms. So he had to be interrupted mid-sentence. Apologies, Brent. I'm not quite sure what he was chatting on about, but we had to interrupt him. Come, on you go. We're nearly out of the traffic jam. We've got one more straggler, and then we can go and investigate. First of all, there's ground hornbill calling in this direction. And second of all, I did hear zebra yipping at each other, but they've stopped now. One straggling female. I'm just going to take my earpiece out for 1 second. Just want to get a direction on these ground hornbill. Eek. Let's go Aubrey's Road. I think they're somewhere that way. We do, of course, have two ears on either side of our heads in order to gauge direction that a sound is coming from, which is why I have to take the earpiece out when I really want to narrow it down. Now, the sound I'm hearing is going goo-gook, goo-gook-gook. And to me, the ground hornbill sound, first thing in the morning, and I'm hoping I can find them for you, to me, the ground hornbill sound is almost prehistoric. No, not prehistoric. That's not what I'm looking for. To me, it's like the music of some kind of mysterious ancient civilization. Is more accurate. That's more the way I feel about it. Now let me see if I can't find them for you. They're probably up near the fire break. This is a game I used to play. I say game. This is what I used to do in the job I had prior to this one. Get up at 3 o'clock in the morning, go out just before light in summer because it's breeding season for the ground hornbills. And then drive to somewhere where we thought they might be and just listen. And then drive a bit closer and drive a bit closer and drive a bit closer until we got as close as we could get on a road, at which point we'd jump out of the vehicle and go sprinting off into the bush to go and find where these ground hornbill were nesting. Because They often, when they're nesting, they only chorus in the mornings, first thing in the mornings, and by the time 7 o'clock rolls around, they stop. We'd go and search for their nest sites. But it has been a long time since I've had to chase down a ground hornbill. We are, by the way, slowly making our way towards those lions. There's no rush, they're not moving anywhere, they're north of our boundary. We might have to, we're going to go and see. Aubrey says he's not even sure if we're going to have a view of them from the boundary, so I'm not racing off. Okay, let's do a stop and listen again. Hear a crested barbet somewhere. Okay, while I listen carefully for the ground hornbill, I think we're going to try again and go back across to Brent. Hopefully he is able to hear what Kirsty is saying.
Very exciting. Now, this could be a very much a new bird species for a lot of you out there. It is a black-breasted snake eagle. And you can see those wonderful eyes. There we go. You can see the shape of the head, very snake eagle-ish. Well, I suppose not very snake eagle-ish, it's very snake eagle. So you can see that is a black-breasted snake eagle. I'm going to try and get a little bit closer. I just wanted to get a make sure shot before we moved on. Now, if this is a new bird for you, let me know. Hashtag Safari Live. Or questions at wildearth.tv. Now, for those of you who might be new, a lot of our viewers like to keep a list of all the birds we see on the live safari, and also of all the animals and trees and plants and flowers and bugs and butterflies and everything. But isn't that, it's just a very beautiful bird, not one we see too commonly up here in the northern Sabi Sands. So I'm very excited to see the black-breasted snake eagle down on Cheetah Plains. Let's try and get a bit closer. I want to get a photograph of it as well. Unfortunately, there's a road that leads right to where he is, or she is, but far too much. And you can't really tell the sex. This is between the snake eagles. They are very similar. No sexual dimorphism. Oh, he flew away before we even got there. Did he go down to the ground? No, there he goes. Oh dear, well, at least we got to see him. He's landed in the tree even further away now. There we go, and you might hear the radio there. The sticks are in Inkoro. There we go, the black-breasted snake eagle. Yay! The birds have been fantastic over the last little while. Of course, the biggest bird species we got recently was yesterday on the sunset safari. I nearly danced out of my seat. I was so excited because so many people have asked about it and wanted to see it. And for the first time on Safari Live, we saw a broad-billed roller. It was wonderful. Such a beautiful bird. And I even got to learn a bit of German thanks to RC. Okay, so let's head back up onto the crest and towards Three in a Row Pan, and then onward to the vast open plains. a very interesting question from Chai. Connie is wondering, is the African bush louder at dusk or dawn? Well, I say it all depends on the dusk or dawn, but on average, I would say probably louder at dawn. And the bird, well, definitely the birds are more active at that time of the day. But it depends. Some afternoons there can be an absolute cacophony. Oh, don't run away now, kudus. Here we go. Some more African antelope. One of the bigger species of antelope we get here. And it is the kudu. Those are females. And the males have massive curled horns. They are very pretty antelope. Go. Okay, so I know it sounds like you were discussing with Jamie about kudus, and they would be the African version of that's what that came through. Sorry, Kirsten. And we do apologize for these comms issues. We are putting in a digital system that will make life a lot easier. But as with new systems, there's a few kinks to work out. Now, not only are there kudu here and impala, there we go. African version of Santa's reindeer. That's a very good description. They're about similar size. Okay. There you go. Some more buffalo. Buffalo everywhere. Now, where are the lions that are supposed to be on top of them? Dave, why did you chase the lions away? So, now we're quite close to 3 in a row pan, and these buffalo are spread through the bush here. I want to head towards the pan, see if there are any still drinking. Hello, buffaloes. Bye, buffaloes. Now, I'm just so happy the weather has warmed up again and the migratory birds have arrived. We've got cuckoos. We've got broad-billed rollers. We've seen a black-breasted snake eagle. What else could we find this morning? I'm very excited to continue birding. Oh, speaking of birds, there's a whole flock of wattled starlings. Now, they are often found following big herds of buffalo as the buffalo stomp and disturb all sorts of insects. They're there to take advantage. But quickly across to Jamie, who's got the biggest member of the hornbill family.
Just listen to this, listen to the sounds.
Station, you can cross into Buffalo.
Beautiful sound. We've managed to find the ground hornbill. And we can see them calling. Looks like the male, lacking the blue spot under the chin. Yep, that's the male. See how he's using that pouch as a resonating chamber? Can you hear it? There's two on my right, and you can't see them at the moment, so we're not going to look there yet. But there are two on my left as well. Beautiful. There's the female. Blue spot under her chin. Just underneath the bill. Aren't they beautiful birds? They're absolutely incredible. Managed to catch a cricket or a cicada, maybe something with wings. Oh, you dropped it. You're not interested in that. Huh. What a stunning sighting. And Debbie in Vancouver, you wanted to know, what do ground hornbill nests look like? Now, they're very, very particular, and we're going to discuss for new viewers, we'll discuss a little bit more about the ground hornbill in a moment. They're very, very particular about their nesting sites. They pick big trees like marula trees or jackalberry trees, sometimes leadwood trees, and essentially are just looking for a hollow in the tree. You know, similar to the bush baby nest that we found in the past. They look relatively similar to that. So it's just a hollow in the tree itself, a part where it's been rotted away, eaten away by insects or borer beetles. And they settle in there, and it's quite, they can be quite small nesting holes for such a big bird. These birds, as I said, reach up to 6 kilograms, so over close to 13, 14 pounds in weight. And they're very, very particular. They use the same nest site over and over and over again. Oh, we're going to just go backwards a little bit. Let's look over there on our left-hand side. See if we can spot them on the left. Carrie, you want to know if they are related to turkeys. And the answer is no, they're not, although they look of a similar size. Where have these things gone now? I'm sure I saw them. I've got them here. They're coming through. There we go. Let's give it a go. Oh, there we go. So Carrie, whilst they're about turkey-sized, and of course they've got those funny bald patches around their face, they are not related to turkeys. They are related to hornbills, which is a separate branch of the family completely. Well, they are absolutely massive. You know, they're roughly turkey-sized. Now, for our new viewers, this bird is truly, truly special, and we appreciate each and every sighting that we have with them. They are critically endangered. They have come back from the brink of extinction before. Oh, they're so noisy this morning. Now there's a conservative, I don't actually really want to talk, it's such a beautiful sound. Whole family group of them. I'm trying to work out the dynamics here. Mm-hmm. We'll go into a discussion a bit later, but for now let's just appreciate a sound that we don't often get to hear. What a stunning chorus. Break for breakfast. So far this male seems to be grabbing one thing, dropping it and grabbing something else that seems more delicious. As I said, we appreciate each and every sighting with these animals, and I'm going to go back again. They're all walking parallel to us, two on one side, two on the other, and I want to just get an idea of the dynamics of the tornbills on our left, because we record and report all sightings of these birds. Excuse me. Let's try and... Oh, are there actually five here? There are. There's five ground hornbills in this group. How magical. It's not four, it's five. Here's one right at the back. Looks like a... could be a male. It's hard to tell. There's another one there. Looks like a female. There's actually a third one on our left-hand side as well. Look at what that one's got. It's a massive moth. Yeah, that's a male. Now, Karen, in New York, you wanted to know, because as we watch them, they're sort of strutting slowly along the ground. You want to know if they can move quickly, because they seem to move so slow. They're not very rapid ground movers. They can run, but it's a very cumbersome jog, and it's quite silly looking. But they can fly. Although they look like big and bulky birds, they are more than capable of taking to the skies, and they do on a regular basis. So yes, they can fly. I just want to get an idea of what's going on here, what kind of family group we have. Oh, this is wonderful. You got some behind you there. They can move rapidly through the air. Now one of the big reasons that these birds are so endangered, and to explain the dynamics of this family group, they live together with a male and a female, and they produce two eggs in a year, but only one offspring will survive. And that ground hornbill will take 7 years to reach sexual maturity. And during that time it will spend it with their parents in little family groups, kind of like jackal in a way, whilst they mature. They will spend their time with their families helping to raise the next generation or the next set of chicks. So that's what we've got happening here. We've got a male and a female and then their offspring. And it's just a matter of figuring out the dynamics from there. So there you go. Christine, you wanted to know if they stay in pairs for life. Yes, they do. They are monogamous birds and they will mate for life. And then, of course, they've got their offspring hanging around, their adult children hanging around until they reach sexual maturity and disperse. So they're long-lived birds, and generally long-lived animals are quite slow to breed. They invest a great deal of time and in their offspring. Then, of course, massive loss of habitat over the years, as well as people killing them for traditional medicinal uses. I don't know what they are. I know that there are some, and that there are a bird that has local superstition attached to them. And then combine that with the fact that they are notorious window breakers. With their powerful bills, They are more than capable of smashing windows, which they do on a regular basis, because whilst they are lovely birds, they haven't quite, much like their other hornbill cousins, they haven't quite grasped the concept of the fact that a reflection does not make a rival bird. They're keeping us guessing, these hornbill, constantly on the move. So what they do is they go and attack their reflection. It's fine when they're yellow-billed or red-billed hornbills, but when it is a bird as massive as this, they'll break through the glass, and that in turn gets them labelled as a nuisance and a pest, especially for people who can't afford to keep replacing their windows. Beware in Kruger, all of you who pay visits to Kruger National Park. The hornbills there have also learned to attack cars, which is hilarious to witness. I've seen one or two tourists absolutely flummoxed as to what on earth they can do against the onslaught of a group of massive birds attacking their rental car. It is a little bit entertaining to watch, I have to say. And of course, they're entirely protected in the Kruger. So it's just generally good fun. So if you do go to Kruger and you do pay a visit, I said that we record each and every detail of the sightings we have. Please record any tags. And Mauritius, good question. Why are they calling if they are all in close proximity to each other? It's just staying in contact. You'll see that dwarf mongoose will do it as well. There's quite a few bird species that, as they forage, will sort of constantly call together. And as soon as one starts, the other carries on. It's sort of allomimicry. They can't stop themselves. Once one starts to call, the rest of them go. Babblers, wood hoopoes. Even though, bear in mind also, they're in dense vegetation and they are not the same height as we are. They're quite a lot smaller. So that just allows them to sort of constantly contact call. There's probably about a good 70 meter gap between the furthest ones on either side. All of them I've lost now. There's a good 70 meter gap. So it's a contact call, but it's also, in the morning like this morning, it's a dawn chorus. So it's them announcing to other groups of ground hornbill that they are in this area and this is their place. And it's not for anybody else, any other ground hornbills, to come in here and usurp it. Might even find that they are thinking about looking for a nest site. Wouldn't that be wonderful? This is the second time I've seen them here. They could go one of two ways. Buffleshook on my right and my left, and Juma on my right. So it's a dawn chorus, just like all of our other birds. I don't know. Ashton, I don't know. I have no idea why the ground hornbill picked up. Both of them did it. Both of the ones we were watching with food in their mouths had something in their mouth and didn't eat it. From the male that we saw earlier with the cicada, and then the one with the moth. And now this one's got something. It looks like a dung beetle. And I'm not quite sure. I don't know if it's the desire for better food or if it's part of a mating ritual, because it's both the males that seem to be doing this. This is a male as well. An interesting dynamic we've got going on here. I haven't seen any juveniles. So there you go, Siberia Zumi. You and I are on the same page. We've spoken there. Okay, this one's eating it. He's slightly smaller than the male we saw on the other side of us. Now, Siberia Zumi's on the same page in his suggestion of the answer to Ashton's question. It's entirely possible that it is a courting a female. Look, everybody, Buffleshook sign. What a nice image. Wish I had a camera. So what hornbills do, and we've spoken about it with yellow-billed hornbills and with red-billed hornbills, the fact that the male will bring female food in order to convince her that he's capable of looking after her when she nests. And that's because in the yellow-billed and the red-billed hornbills, they lose all of their primary feathers when they nest, the females, and they block themselves in, and they are entirely reliant on the male to keep them well fed. Now, it's possible that the ground hornbills also follow that ritual, and maybe that's why. That's the explanation behind this running around with food in their beaks. Maybe this is a female. She does actually appear to have a blue spot under her chin. I'm confused as to this dynamics. Private nature reserve. and one frantically moving. Oh, hold on, look. Is it going to feed it? Look. Yep. Look at this. Oh, this is incredible. Oh, I hope you're getting some amazing screenshots of this. That was weird. I thought the one was going to go and feed the other, but they kind of met in the middle, looked at each other for a while, reared up, and then moved off their separate ways. Such magnificent birds. I'm going to ask some people in the know about the differences in dynamics of these hornbills, because this is interesting interaction. I mean, this is definitely, they are part of the same group. They're part of the same family. I'm just not quite sure who's dominant here and who's not. It's amazing to see this interaction. I've never seen that before. They're sort of going towards each other and then rearing up. Wings are slightly open. This is stunning. Absolutely stunning. I'm glad we decided to follow the calls of the ground hornbills. There's one other option with this. And I must just think through it carefully. It could be a dispersal group, an adult dispersal group. So once the chicks do reach sexual maturity, obviously they have to move off in search of breeding prospects. And what they'll do is they'll often disperse in groups together. And it's usually male and female groups. And that's why I'm trying to work out the dynamics here. Trying to get a handle on how many females and males we have. I think those bald patches, I actually think we've got a group of males. I think the one I identified earlier as a female might actually be a male. Those dots are not underneath their chins, are not clear enough. The females have bluish patches underneath their bills. I think those are just rubbed patches, bald patches underneath their chins. It's not a female. It makes me think we might actually have a dispersal group of males. But let's wait and see. I want to just see how the situation plays out, and I wanted to go back through this footage later and just chat with some of the experts I know on ground hornbill behavior. It would be very interesting to get an idea. This is the joy of the live safaris, is you get to see things that we hardly ever get to see. Moments like this are really truly special. I'm going to stick with them for now and keep checking, but this morning's proving to be a stunning bird morning. Let's have a quick look at what Brent has found.
Oh, we are live. Hi. Sorry, we're having the comms issues. I didn't see that one come through. So the reason we're live and we're coming to you with no radio is that there are the first European beaters of the season. They're all around us. I've just moved. Of course, there comes one, Dave. There we go. We saw them fly across quarantine, but they didn't hang around. Now they are literally hundreds of them here on Cheetah Plains, and they are going to land shortly, so I will find you a nice view of one. But how lucky, how wonderful. There's one that has landed. European bee eaters of the rainy season. Okay, there we go. You see him, Dave? Okay, see that? You got him. Oh, and he takes off. Where are they gone? They're being tricky. They're just tricking Dave. There's so many of them, but they're just not sitting still. They're all hungry after their long migration all the way from Europe. Just trying to see where's going to be the best option. I see them flying everywhere. There's some. Let's go down there. There seem to be more, a little bit to that side. Okay, give us a few seconds. Let's find a good view of a European bee eater quickly. Now, this is obviously quite unusual for us. We're not having a... Oh, no, he flew. Okay. Okay, there's one sitting. We're going to go for the long shot. Okay, Dave, let me just have a look. Where are we looking? There. Hang on, have I lost sight of him? No, down to the left a little bit. Up. Center frame. Down a little bit. There we go. There it is. Look at those beautiful colors of the European bee eater. Now, I'm sure we're going to see lots of them a lot closer. We are going to start running back towards Juma, where we can... Our radio seem to work for now. And while we do that, before we go, one more bird for the road before we send you back to Jamie. Oh, interesting. Is that a very brief view of a Warburg's eagle? Okay, there it goes. So as the Warburg's flies off, we're going to fly back to Juma. And while we do that, let's go back to Jamie.
I'm still with these ground hornbill, and I find myself absolutely fascinated by them. For a bird that can live, okay, this is in captivity, but they've been recorded to live up to 70 years old. So when I said earlier that they are long-lived birds, they really, really are. And in the wild, thought to have a life expectancy of around 30 years. And I'm very curious to see, I'm waiting for all of them to gather together. I'm hoping that that's going to happen because so far I haven't seen a female. I thought I saw a female initially, but I haven't. That skin on the bottom of the throat is not blue enough for an adult female. Now, interestingly enough, we could still, because I haven't had a close look at one of them. So it could be a female and a male, so a breeding pair, with all male offspring. Now here's the amazing thing, and one of the reasons why they're wonderful birds, but they're not very successful in the wild. Research seems to suggest that unless a bird, and this is through hand-reared specimens, because they have been involved in lots and lots of breeding projects to try and release into the wild, unless they are put as part of a cooperative breeding group when they're young, in other words, helping a breeding pair to raise chicks, they won't breed themselves successfully. That, unlike most other animals, that breeding instinct, that nesting instinct is not fully instinctive and they have to learn it. They have to learn about how this whole process works, quite literally in a way, learning about the birds and the bees. Trying to figure out how it all works and how the dynamics interact is a different story completely. But how interesting is that? Unless they help their parents, they won't be able to successfully breed themselves. Now, I have heard stories of some groups, some young hornbills joining other breeding pairs, which is even more incredible. So other adults that aren't related to them, because usually you can understand that whole process. You can understand the whole process of a cooperative breeding if basically a sibling shares 50% of your DNA. It makes sense to try and help rear them biologically. But the fact that sometimes young ground hornbills join other breeding pairs to help them raise their chicks is also a truly fascinating dynamic. So these birds are really truly unique in terms of the way that they operate and their social structure. There is nothing out here that adopts a similar approach, and unfortunately it has been to their detriment. It means that they're very, very slow to grow the population, kind of like pandas in a way, relatively unsuccessful in the way they go about things in terms of making more ground hornbills. You see what I mean? See why there was such a hurry though to get to the sound? They've stopped completely. The Mauritia, what we were talking about, contact calls earlier, they're not contact calling anymore. So it must have been purely a dawn chorus process, purely letting other ground hornbills not part of this group know where they are. So it had they weren't calling to each other. It was for territorial purposes. Kathy, yes, you're looking at 5 of roughly 1,400 left in the world. That is a rough estimate. It's obviously difficult to know exactly because they're birds, they have wings. It's difficult to estimate an exact population, but research, okay, it might have changed. The last proper census that I heard about was around 2009-2010. So they've had 6 years for that population dynamic to change, but they're sitting at around 1,400, maybe 1,500, give or take. There's a massive margin of error from researchers. Either way, the numbers are small, and researchers into ground hornbills have suggested that that actually equates to only around 400 to 500 breeding females, so females of breeding age, which is quite a scary thought, isn't it? That there are so few left in the world, which is, as we've said earlier, why we've got to appreciate each and every moment spent with these magnificent creatures. They are as special and as rare as wild dog. That was wonderful. What a truly spectacular sighting. I wonder where they're planning on going. Keep moving towards Sydney's dam. Yes, I can, Anne, with pleasure. What a good idea. Anne would like to see a ground hornbill track. Right. Since our ground hornbill have largely disappeared, they must have crossed somewhere here. Hopefully I haven't obliterated it already. Otherwise, there should be some further back that side. I will show you a ground hornbill track with pleasure. This isn't the best sand in the world. Okay, I've got their tracks, but it's not very clear. Let's go back to Buffalo's cut line where we saw the two of them meet and cross. Let's go that side. Let's try it from that side. So it's very, very similar to all hornbill tracks are the same. They're the banana birds. Their tracks are shaped like bananas, and their outside toes are partially fused to create extra stability. So basically, like, I don't know, I'll have to try and draw it for you. But you should see it on the track as well. Okay, they cross just here. Let's find a nice example. Such a pity this is such sandy soil where they've crossed. It was about here that they met in the middle. Ah, dear. Promised you a track. I've got to find you one. It's just tricky soil and tricky light. No, none of these are clear ground hornbill tracks. How frustrating. My apologies, I can't find you a good track to show you. They're all thoroughly indistinct. There's going to be a perfect track there, but I can't. I just can't quite justify going onto Bubbles Hook for a hornbill track. Cindy, speaking of hornbills, while I attempt one more time to get this right, it's frustrating me now. You wanted to know if there are any successful breeding programs. Yes, there are. And the Mabula Ground Hornbill Project has successfully released adults into the wild that have gone on to survive and to breed. It's a complex process and they usually only have space for a certain number of birds. So how it works, because the second egg dies, the second chick will always die, because it is outcompeted. Siblicide is very common with ground hornbills. And I'm sorry, I'm not looking at you. It's not because I'm ignoring you. I'm just looking for these tracks because it's frustrating me. What they'll do is they'll take the second egg and they will hand raise it in captivity, but they do it with puppets so that the birds do not imprint on the handlers. From there, they will slowly but surely introduce them into a... Yes, there we go. Got it. Sorry, that took me far too long. Okay, I'm going to have to get out to show you this track because at the moment it's just dots in the sand. Actually, it's not that unclear. So what they do after I will get out and speak about this when I'm finished with the chat about raising them. Once they have hand raised them to the juvenile stage where they are capable of moving about on their own, is they will create artificial cooperative breeding groups. So they'll put them together in different age groups so that they can learn behavior from the others. And then they'll have a sort of established breeding pairs that they will then introduce the chicks or the juveniles to and the subadults to so that they can learn the whole process. It's an incredible program. It takes a huge amount of work, a huge amount of effort. And it is truly phenomenal that people are able to do that. So our ground hornbill track, unfortunately, as I said, it's not the most fantastic soil for it, hence why it actually took me a while to find initially. This is the ground hornbill track here. The back foot, its back foot has fallen into this dot. I'm not going to mess up the track in any way, just to point it out to you. This is the back foot here. And these are the front three toes. The outside toe, this is the left foot. This whole foot is the left foot of the hornbill. These two outside toes, so the middle and then the outside toe, are partially fused together here. So there's no separation. This is all fused, whereas this toe here on the inside of their leg is completely separate from the rest of the track. And all in all, what will happen without drawing on the track itself, you'll get this kind of shape, so the banana shape. The left track will look like this. And the right track will look a little bit like this. So they sort of go inwards facing. Right, there you go. Not the best ground hornbill track I've ever found, but it will have to do. It's as good as it gets. There's one here, but it's not clear at all. The one actually came out this way, which is frustrating. Oh, here we go. Can you see this track, Vim? Over here. Is it? Not really. No. You can see how difficult it was for me to try and find you a track. This is the track. This is the back foot and the three front feet. So again, left foot, but going that way. Very inconsiderate of them not to walk on soft sand. It's a ground hornbill watching me. I'll turn around to show you now. Phew. Okay, I think I'm going to steadily move on towards the lions, see if we can see them. In the meantime, let's head across to Brent, who is with something very much larger.
Well, we've got a wonderful traffic jam. He's just seen a kudu that gave him a bit of a fright. Look at this, a massive elephant bull. And I think he's gonna go have a drink shortly, so I'm following him towards the Cheetah Plains Lodge Pan. Hello, big boy. big adult bull in his probably between 30 and 40. Oh, he's getting the water walk. He's getting the water walk. Okay, I'm just going to jump around ahead of him to get to the water before him. Andrew. Isn't this exciting?
Good vibrating.
Andrew, can I go to the Mati in front of your car? It is in Glove.
Yeah, no problem. You can go there. Then, yeah, no problem.
Copy, thanks very much. Sorry, I just had to check that there were no guests napping in. Suddenly, with some buffalo here as well. Oh, is he going to walk to the water? The water's just in front of us here. I'm really hoping he goes for a drink. Oh, look at that. I just love big Ellie bulls. Look, the water walk. The water walk. You get thawed. I love it when elephants do that. You can just check their body language. It starts becoming a little bit more bouncy. He's going straight for the water. Big boy! Don't spray us now when you are in the water. There's another bird while we wait for him to come down towards us. It's a little three-banded. The bird is. It's probably going to be disturbed by the elephant. Here he comes. Oh yes, here he comes. Oh, I love it so much. Where are you going? The water's this way. Hey, big boy. Straight to the water's edge. That was a bit close. That nearly got to us. Dave, have you showered this morning?
Nope.
Oh, well, we might get in luck. We might be showered by an elephant. Just gonna keep quiet so you can hear when he slurps the water in. Is just magnificent. Now this is right in front of the Cheetah Plains Lodge. Sometimes it's just nice to sit quietly and really just take in these animals. Speaking of that, quietly, let's just turn the radio off completely.
goodbye, and we can listen carefully. That water dribbling off his chin. Hi, David in Napa, California. David is wondering why elephants do that water walk. Is it for a reason? Well, David, I think it's probably the same as quite a few of the residents of Napa do the wine walk as they approach the wineries. I think just gets excited for a drink, and that's where it comes from. They can smell the water and they sort of get excited and start speeding up as they head towards it. Hey, mister. Now he's smelling elephant dung. Obviously been a breeding herd around here at some point. Connor is wondering, how much water can an elephant drink in one sitting? Is it limited, or can they drink as much as they want? Well, a big Eddie bull like this, over a course of a day, is capable of drinking up to 100 litres, which is just under 20 gallons, if my maths is correct. Now, Dave, let's zoom in on... Oh, no, don't worry, it's disappeared now. I'll keep looking for it. There was one of my favorite butterflies around the elephant's feet, but he's coming back on the back foot. Oh no, he's gone away now. Sorry, butterflies are very... Well, I'll wait for him to land, I'll tell you. He's just come out, Dev. On the ground down here. There we go, look at that. Now, oh, that's a false acria, if I remember correctly. I don't have my butterfly book. I definitely need to start carrying it with me. But isn't that just absolutely gorgeous? Poof, off it flutters. It looked like one of the false acrias. But I'll have to double check that when I get home. So, one of the incredible things is when we arrived, this little pan was overflowing with water, and he's drunk enough that it is no longer. So he's drunk a good probably 20 liters or 30 liters already. Now in his trunk he can hold about 8 liters, just under 2 gallons of water in his trunk. Is he done yet? Okay, smelling the other elephant dung again, picking up information from it. Oh, and looks like he's going to come right up to the vehicle. Hi, big guy. Oh, he's beautiful. Where are you off to next? Are you following the trail of a herd? Or are you going to stop for a snack on the acacia that's above you? I think he is going to stretch.
Now, those leaves are out of reach of the females and the breeding herds. And you can see that they've kept it very, very highly trimmed, this large knob thorn. Are we going to sit here with this elephant bull for a bit longer, see if he gets up to any shenanigans while we do that? Seems like Jamie is keeping our cat streak on the go.
Well, I would hate to have broken our cat streak, and hence the trip to the eastern side of Tamboerti Dam in Buffalo's Hook. Now, unfortunately for our new viewers, this is outside what's known as a traverse area. In other words, we aren't allowed to go there. I'm sitting right on the boundary with my left wheel touching the boundary of Buffalo's Hook, and this is probably the best view that we can get of them. They're sitting in the Tamboerti thicket, so close, and yet so far. So there we go. They're very, very close. You might have seen the cub there briefly going up to greet one of the lionesses. I have absolutely no idea how many lions there are here. And I'm probably not going to stick here for too long. Just nice to touch base, see the Nkuhumas. It's been a while since we have. And you know, we're starting to get withdrawal symptoms since we've been accustomed to seeing them each and every single day with their gorgeous cubs. It does stand to reason. It's a good thing that we enjoyed as much time with them as possible, because now that the cubs are a little bit larger, they're going to be utilizing... Oh, bless you, girl. They're going to be utilizing more of their territory, which means going up into Buffalo's Hook and into Torchwood as well, which means we won't be able to see them as often. But they're so close. Just come south. Look south. Look to your left and then go that way. It would be lovely if you did that. She's sitting with a full belly. You can see her panting. They've obviously eaten some buffalo recently. And Ellie, welcome to the Sunrise Safari again. I know we spoke earlier with the elephants. You wanted to know whether or not lions will travel on their own or in groups. Oh, here comes a little cub going up to say hello to Mom. One of the oldest or the middle set of cubs. Ellie, the females will travel in prides. So that is a lion pride. A lion pride is, the unit of a lion pride is made up of females and their offspring, and they will all be related to each other, except in absolutely exceptional conditions. The males occasionally do move about on their own, especially if it's the only, if there was only one male born to a pride of that particular generation, like, for example, the previous Nkuhuma male, called nicknamed Junior, who has been hanging around with a new friend that he's found. But life is tough for a male lion on their own, and generally they try and avoid that situation. So if more than one male is born into a generation, can be from different litters but related to each other, they will form what's known as a coalition. And that's what we have as the dominant males of this area. A coalition of four, used to be five males, four males known as the Birmingham Boys. And speaking of the Birmingham Boys, everybody, just for our regular viewers, we will be announcing their names and talking a little bit about why we have named them on the fireside chat this evening. So we will be having a fireside chat. It will be purely devoted to this whole process and how it's all worked out. So if you do have any questions about that, please do join us for the fireside chat. You can send through your questions and your comments in the normal way, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or email through to questions@wildearth.tv. Please do let us know your thoughts, and we will discuss more when we get to that particular appropriate moment. So Ellie, a coalition of males, it doesn't have to be related to each other. Like, for example, the young Nkuhuma male moved off on his own, and he found himself a buddy, another nomadic young male lion, and it's just safer to be in a group. If a male wants to establish their own territory... Good morning, everybody. How are you? Good, thanks. Go for it. We're just sitting here. What was I saying? Oh, yes. It's much easier to establish, because bear in mind, this one of the sole focuses of a male lion's life is to establish himself a territory and breed with females and pass on his genetic line. That is much easier to do if you've got the advantage of numbers, as the Birmingham Boys had. And so they're not too fussy about joining up with other young males. As long as they all get a chance to mate, they're happy. And advantage of numbers outweighs all the other negatives. We've got lion prides and male lion coalitions. In this case, Ellie, there are 5 lionesses in this pride and 8 cubs. And they are currently dominated over by the Birmingham boys, the dominant males in this area. The Birmingham boys only came into power for Ellie and for all of our new viewers. They only came into control of this area a year and a half-ish ago. Where are we? It was about 1 year and 3 months ago that they fully established themselves, kicking out the resident dominant males, the Matimba males. And it's a short-lived affair. Male lions live brutal, very tough lives. And they will only, in answer to Brian's question, they generally are only in power for about roughly 2, 2.5 years, sometimes 3. But that depends very much on the dynamics of the area. So essentially, that is why when a male lion comes into a new area and establishes himself, he will go out and systematically kill all of the cubs of the previous dominant males. And he does that because he has no idea how long he is going to be able to maintain that territory. So it brings the females back into estrus faster. He doesn't waste any energy protecting cubs that are not his. And he can breed and reproduce and hopefully raise that generation to adulthood or be in control of the area whilst the lionesses raise that generation to adulthood. At which point, chances are he is going to be kicked out. There will be another group of young male lions in an area like this, as massive as this, with such a healthy lion population. There are constantly up-and-coming young male coalitions and solitary young males that are constantly growing in strength and size and are able to challenge the dominant males in an area. The Birmingham boys might last a little bit longer, but we can't say for certain. I mean, it's just because they're young. They're only going to get bigger and stronger. They established themselves here when the youngest of them was probably just over 4 years old, which is relatively early for a male coalition. There's a chance they might stay for longer, but that's generally not, that's what actually nature wants to avoid, that kind of scenario, because otherwise what will start happening, let's say that male has produced female cubs and they're now 2.5 years old, they're going to start going into estrus and he will start mating with them. So you start to run the risk of inbreeding if a male lion or a group of male lions stays in control of an area for longer than around 2 years. Let's try a reposition. Let's see if we can see any better from a different side. I don't think so, though. I think this is probably going to be the extent of our lion sighting. Hopefully they decide to come south. There is, unfortunately for us, not unfortunately for the animals, there's water in Tambuiti Dam, which is this waterhole that they're next to. So they have no real reason to go south unless a buffalo herd comes wandering through. I think the dam wall's going to get very much in our way. Very valid point from Marianne in Texas. Yes, absolutely. Once the Nkumas start to push into Torchwood, it does to an extent overlap with the Torchwood Pride territory. And bear in mind, territories are not like jigsaw puzzles. They don't fit perfectly together with an established boundary like a puzzle piece. They overlap. The boundaries are fluid. The Nkuhuma lioness, the first one to give birth, actually gave birth on Torchwood. The Nkuhumas have always dominated right up until about 2/3 into Torchwood, at which point the Torchwood Pride territory is sort of more towards Kruger in that area. And for the most part, prides are good at avoiding each other. So the fact that the Nkumas have spent so much time here is one of the reasons why the Torchwood Pride have started pushing back into, I think, what was their old territory in Torchwood. But they only really utilize the eastern boundary of Torchwood, whereas the Nkuma spend a lot of time in the western portions. First rock, second rock, those large sort of prominent rocks in Torchwood itself. I'm sorry. There's no good view. There's some trees, there's some bushes, and one cave viewing vehicle that can go onto Buffleshook. Sorry. Everybody, I think that's sort of the end of our, or extent of our lion sighting. There's some trees blowing in the wind, but no lions. So what will happen if the Nkumas start pushing back into Torchwood? They'll start to become more and more vocal, just to re-establish themselves, and chances are that will be resolved without any kind of confrontation between the two prides. Lionesses are usually quite good at that. Occasionally they encounter each other and it can turn into quite a nasty scrap. They can do damage to each other and they can fight almost as seriously as the males do. But for the most part, roaring at night, just establishing themselves slowly but surely is a good way of avoiding it. And lions are very good at listening, far better than human beings in my opinion. They listen to the sounds of the roars and they can do a head count and go, actually, it's really not worth taking on five lionesses that sound quite large, and the Nkumas are quite large, and they sound as though they're determined, let's move off. Or vice versa, it could work the other way around. The Torchwood females could outcompete the Nkumas, make a bigger noise, and the Nkumas could just stick around here. But I think they're going to push back into Torchwood. The Nkumas have always had a massive, massive home range. Let me just move out of the way so that Mike can make his way to the Nkuhumas. I want to show you something once Mike comes past about how close we came to getting Nkuhumas on Juma. Good morning, everybody. How's it? How are you? Cool. Hi, guys. Are you on your way to Nkuhumas? Cool. Enjoy. Scoot them this way. Yeah, there is one station on lock, so you'll see them clearly. Cool. Enjoy.
Yeah.
Cheers. Right, let me go show you what I was going to show you. This must be the tracks from that mating pair of Nkuhuma lioness and Birmingham boy, and then the other male that joined them that you saw on the dam camera. Oh dear. I think that my forward thinking in moving away from Mike has meant that he's had to go round. He might have driven over them. There we go. Now, speaking of the Birmingham boys, I think it was Lauren, you wanted to know about how you can watch the fireside chat and whether or where we can watch it and how the Birmingham boy is with the hole in his face on his right-hand cheek. I'm not too sure which lions you saw on the Juma Dam camera last night. There's some males' tracks. I'm not going to go get out of the vehicle because I don't want to startle the lions. They're quite sharp-eyed and chances are they will see me. But there is a male lion track going into Juma. I'm not sure which lions came through. But last time I saw the male lion with the hole in his face, he was looking much, much better. To me, he's one of the dominant members at the moment of the Birmingham boys. He's a big, big boy. He's a big male. He's much larger than his counterpart, number three, that spends a lot of time with him. And he seems to be the one who manages to monopolize the attention of the ladies for the most part. But he was healing up beautifully. That cheek was all pink and healing. Flesh was coming back. It looked far better when I last saw him. So you can be comforted in that. In terms of the fireside chat, same time, same place, the same way you watch our sunrise and sunset safaris. It will be, unless I'm very much mistaken, and Kirsty will correct me if I am, it will be the last 15 minutes of the sunset safari that will be the fireside chat. And goodness gracious, how exciting. Of course, we're getting a whole host of people returning to us once again, including Taylor and Mr. Hendry. While I continue on and hope that the Nkuhumas come south, let's go back across to Brent and find out whether he's on Cheetah Plains, Juma, where he is in the world.
Dave, what's that noise? Do you not know? Can you hear that, Dave? Just flew into me. I'm trying to be gentle. How close can I get, Dave?
Yeah, that's cool.
Look at that. The first cicada I've caught this year. Now, the funniest thing about cicadas is how you hold them depends on whether they scream at you. So let me just do this. You hold them like that, they don't stop. So this looks like a little redback cicada. I'm just trying to be very gentle with him. He wasn't gentle with me when he flew into me, so there we go. You want us to bring it closer?
Yeah.
So I'm going to let him go shortly. And say, there we go. So that's the bug you hear screaming all the time. Actually, I thought this was a redback cicada. I just want to have a quick look at it again. Sorry, I'm going to take it away. It could be a green or gold as well. I'm going to have to. I'm a bit rusty on my cicadas. But are you ready for the release? And as I said, I'm trying to be gentle with him. He wasn't gentle with me. He literally went into my nose. Now, okay. He's gone. All right, I'll tell you some funny stories about cicadas. Now, you get quite a lot of different species, and up in northern Botswana, you can get cicadas that are this big. And when you're driving through the bush, especially at this time of the year, as the mapanis are flushing green, there are hundreds of thousands, possibly millions of them. And sometimes we weren't in open vehicles, we're in a closed cab Land Cruiser, and off you're going, and one cicada would somehow fly into your window and end up under your seat somewhere screaming. And in a and a really loud, that was quite a quiet one, it was a small one. And literally, you would stop your car and spend 45 minutes digging, taking the seats out, looking under your, in your toolbox, under your spares, just anything to get that out of the inside of your cab. Now, when I was younger, of course I don't do stuff like this anymore. One of my best friends, we were out at a camp right up in the Mapani Fault, north of Naipan, and the cicadas were going mad, and he went to bed early, and a couple of other of us didn't. And that night, I think we caught 55, 60 cicadas, and we placed them strategically all around the cab, inside the cab of his Land Cruiser, and he was leaving early the next morning to go back to Maun. Let's just say there were some choice words used in our direction when we got back into town about a week later. He was not impressed. Now, Dave and I have decided to cruise the Mawati riverbed looking for birds. I can hear him. Oh, but look who's looking down at us so sneakily. You see him, Dave? Okay, left. And up a bit. Oh, you got him. There we go. He was just sort of peering from behind a branch at us, a little vervet monkey, feeding off the fruits of the jackalberry. Now, they do eat leaves as well, but I think in this case, he's definitely after the fruit. Pluck, pluck. I love monkeys. Sometimes they're so scared the other monkeys are going to get there first, or not leave any, that they just literally stuff their cheeks till they're completely full. Let's have a look. This one's a bit more out in the open, a little bit lower. Was it behind a bush for you? No, out of it. Far left of the tree. Keep going. Come down. Keep coming down. There. Yeah, let's wait to see if it's got the fat cheeks. Whoa, that wasn't so elegant. Let's see, there we go. Are we getting puffy cheeks? Not yet. Lots of animals love the fruit of the jackalberry. And none such more than the vervet monkey. Right, let's leave the vervet monkeys to eat their breakfast. And it seems like I've managed to find... I'm really hoping to find some cuckoos today. No, Dave, stop cuckooing. We've seen a cuckoo now, no more cuckooing. It is very much sounds like a Monty Python skit to me, but anyway, carrying on. Also, of course, as we delve into the Mawati River, we're on the search of the nemesis bird. Now, we're not the only bird in search of the nemesis bird. So, as I said, we're in search of the white-throated robin chat. We've only managed to get it once on camera, and it was right here. Now, the red-chested cuckoo, who we are in search for as well. Oh, sorry. Yes. Yes, the red-chested cuckoo, not the black cuckoo. The black cuckoo is different, has a different brood parasite. So the red-chested cuckoo is also in search of the white-throated robin chat as one of its favorite hosts. So what they'll do is they'll pop their eggs in, kick the white-throated robin chat's eggs out, and get the robin to do the parental work for them. I do love coming down into the Mawati, especially as it gets a bit warmer and we come into the shade and under the glorious trees. Hornbills making lots of noise. Can't see where they are, top of the tree somewhere. Now this is the white-throated robin's chat's hangout. Well, where we hear and see them the most commonly. I think I spotted him. Okay, there's a little bird party, and I think I might have got a glimpse of the robin chat. Definitely a Karachani thrush as well. Chai Connie's wondering if we get European storks in South Africa. Oh, I'm gonna start off with it. Looks like a bearded woodpecker. Wait, go top first. Bit higher, I think. Oh, it's gone. No, it's still there. What was that? Oh, a black-collared barbet. There we go. So I said there's a little bird party here, so that's the first species. There's a bearded woodpecker in and around there somewhere. Let's keep moving forward. Sorry, Chai Connie, I got so distracted there. Is wondering whether we get white storks here in South Africa. We do. Sometimes even, we might even get them at Juma from time to time, depending on rainfall and insect numbers. But you definitely get them on the high veld of South Africa where there's lots of grasses. Okay, there goes the barbet. Ah, there's the woodpecker. Looks like a bearded. You got him, Dave? So where the second fork of the long straight, so wait, a little bit higher. Oh, you got him? Oh, there's something else there. No, that is a grey go-away bird in another tree. There we go. Hello, grey go-away bird. Okay, so you're on that left-hand branch that splits into three.
Yes.
He's just popped around behind that one there. Where do you go now? Come on, woodpecker. He's not being very, very forthcoming. Okay, well, maybe we'll see him from the other side of the tree. Oh, there he is, he pops his head up. Wait. Now he's popped his head down. Naughty woodpecker. Okay, other side of the tree, I think, is the option. Of course, as soon as we move again, it's gonna come around the side of the tree. But summer has definitely feels like it's in the air now. So, Robin flew into this area. No sign of it yet. I just really, really like this part of the Mawati, especially this little section over here. Some of my favorite trees on Juma are here. Massive leadwood, massive, massive knob thorns. Look at that, beautiful. This leadwood coming up. One of my favorites, just the shapes on it. probably that Ledwood actually is easily 1,000 years old. Imagine the stories it could tell. A big Ledwood like that. Our Ledwood trees, interestingly, in areas that have gone without water for a long time. A great example of this is certain parts of the Mbabane Depression and the Savuti Marsh in Botswana, is that there are Ledwoods standing there that have probably been dead for 100 years. They can stand, that wood is so dense, they can stand for over 100 years. And it's actually quite a good way when you're moving into a new area. If you find a whole bunch of dead Ledwoods, they've normally drowned. And what happens is there's been obviously a flood or a great rain, and there's been enough water inundating that area for the Ledwoods to die. Oh, hello, Nyala. There you go, male Nyala in the Mwati River. I heard a class's cuckoo calling. He looks a bit bemused. What are you doing in my riverbed? I do love that little white chevron between the Inyala's nose. Now, I know a story that I've told many times, and we've got so many new viewers that I think I'm going to share it again. So the scientific name for the Inyala is Trafalagus angazi. And what happened was, there was a Scotsman who came and landed in what was Port Natal, now Durban, got some Zulu porters and gun bearers, and he went off, as all the naturalists of the 1800s did, with his rifle to try to identify new species. And at that stage, Inyala only lived north of the Tugela River, and Durban or Port Natal is south of the Tugela River. And off he wandered, and just north of the Tugela, he spotted one of these beasts. He shot it in the name of science, and then asked his Zulu staff, "What animal is this?" And they went, "Angazi." So they said, "Oh, that must be the name for it." It is, of course, not an angazi, it's an Inyala. Inyala is a Zulu word, it's a Zulu name. But you must remember that the Zulus to the south didn't often travel that far north. So basically, the Inyala became known as the spiral-horned Trafalagus, that's his family. I don't know. Angazi means I don't know in Zulu. And he doesn't look like he knows who he is either. But let's go across to Jamie with another animal that's got a bit of an identity crisis.
I don't know. I think the zebra are pretty secure in their stripy skin. Luckily, they've got plenty of company, so they can all share their horse with an identity crisis symbol together. All right, just taking a moment to take a sip of water. It is already over 30 degrees in the sun at whatever time of the morning it is, early. At eight in the morning, it is over 30 degrees centigrade, so it's going to be a baking hot, blisteringly hot day today. And of course our zebra, having stood so patiently for us in the road for ages, have decided to go wandering off into the thickets and see if we can catch up with them. And giving us such a beautiful view earlier. One thing I have noticed with this many zebra around, I don't know if it's a result of the amount of zebra we're seeing or if it's just a coincidence, but there's a lot of zebra fights happening. Those of you who watch the Duma Dam camera will probably know what I'm talking about. You will have heard the almost constant yip 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 that the zebra make. And there's lots and lots of conflict, and stallions like this one, I'm just trying to establish if he's part of this herd. I think this is his herd. But it might also be a bachelor group associating with a breeding herd or a harem belonging to one of the stallions. When they blow out of their nose like that, it's talking about botflies and that female buffalo, it's to disrupt the infestations that most of them have in their nostrils and their sinuses. Shame, must be so uncomfortable having fly larvae up in your nose. So that's what they're doing when they're going and shaking their heads. So zebra have an interesting social dynamic. Male will have a collection of females that is known as his harem. which is a lovely description of the way that it works. And he keeps guard behind them, usually walking at the back of the group. And a stallion is very, very defensive of his females. I've seen some truly extraordinary feats of bravery from male zebra. I saw one once, the hyena had, yes, you see, that's where he was walking off to earlier. There's another stallion lurking, and he is not happy about it. This obviously is his herd, and he's keeping a very close eye on a potential rival. As I said, I once had a hyena clan, that had killed a baby zebra and dragged it into a water hole, as they often do. They love storing food in water. And the stallion was desperately and valiantly trying to fight back about six hyena. He would race forward, he'd charge forward with his legs straight, and he'd sort of do this hopping, charging motion to try and scare them off, and then the hyenas would rally and chase him away. And even though this foal was very clearly dead, I don't think he'd realized, and he tried so hard to save it. It was a truly special moment. So they're very protective over their females and over their offspring. But that also includes fighting off rivals. And as I said, I think that there is a lurking stallion here that he's terribly unimpressed with. He's put himself between the herd and the stallion, who's disappeared now. Oh no, I can just see it. He's over there. Just some stripes hidden in the bushes. And I think that's the reason behind the alert and tense posture of the male. And when zebra fight, they really seriously fight. They have sharp teeth, very sharp incisors, and very powerful legs. They kick and they bite, and they can do extraordinary damage to each other. I'll just go forward ever so slightly so we can look at him. He's quite magnificent, this boy. You can see the alertness in the tension of his body. He's not feeding. Heads up, ears forward, looking back constantly in that direction. And tail actually slightly stiff as well. You can read so much into an animal's body language by their tails. And we might even find that these two have already come to blows, although he looks relatively unmarked. Look at him. He's really a magnificent stallion. Very thick, powerful neck. We don't often get to see stallions fighting together, but when you do, it is a true spectacle of nature. It's actually quite scary, the amount of aggression that they can show towards each other. And it's not just the males, the females do it too, particularly in a harem. They kick and they bite each other to make sure everybody knows the hierarchy and doesn't overstep the boundaries. Here we go. I think he feels satisfied now that this male has learnt his lesson. Those strong hooves and powerful legs. You definitely don't want to mess with a male zebra and his harem. It will be an interesting experience. Something that Lexi is my Weimaraner. Lexi learned very quickly. Don't chase zebras. They chase back. And they chase back and they're scary. I'm sorry, I'm thinking. I've got a question that has... Right, let me reposition to get a view of this. It's actually two stallions, and then I'll answer Faith's question, because Faith's question is a very interesting one. Faith would like to know, what are the oddest animal behaviors that have truly stuck in my memory? I'm trying to think. There's odd and then there's extraordinary, and those are two different things. There's moments that have stuck in my memory and will always. For example, the way that all of those elephants gathered when the little elephant calf fell down that hill. Tumbled down that hill, and the way that they reacted and responded, the whole herd moving to comfort that little thing. There was the incident, Faith, this actually wasn't my sighting, but I did watch the clip afterwards, it was tragic, of the stallions, just talking about zebra, the stallions that attacked a foal and proceeded to beat it up in the most horrendous way. They actually ultimately resulted in the death of this poor little thing. A group of stallions gathered around, I think was it Scott, So Scott's sighting, or was it James's? I can't remember. I think it might have been... That was it. Thank you very much, VM. The font of all wisdom. VM says himself and James found it on foot and they called Scott into the sighting on a vehicle. It was an awful sighting to witness. And the zebras are kicking a foal to death, and we've spoken to various people about the explanation behind that behavior. And we were right, by the way. This is two stallions that are lurking on the boundaries. And the explanation was that probably the foal got separated from its family group and started panicking and started making little alarm calls and contact calls, which in turn will potentially attract predators. And zebra respond quite aggressively to animals that put their lives at risk, even if it is just a little foal. But the other explanation, of course, is that it's not their bloodline, it's not their offspring, and therefore they're not invested in protecting it. But it was a truly brutal sighting, and I think that will stick in everybody's memories for a very long time. That's an odd example of animal behavior. As I said, the elephants gathering around to protect that calf, the way the Tundi went to defend her cubs against the baboons. We've seen some truly extraordinary things here. Can you think of any odd sightings, VM, that stick out? But lots of amazing moments, but most of the sightings we have had come with an explanation involved. But that is the joy of the live safaris, is that there's no editing involved. It's not a documentary. It's not really a documentary. It's something completely different. You can't script and put clips in of a completely different animal and pass it off as the same one. It's something totally, totally different. The animals do all of the work for us. It's another odd sighting. I have to think about it, Faith, and get back to you. But that zebra one definitely is high up there. Now these two have obviously been put in their place. He's found a nice patch of shade for now. As herd animals, once they are kicked out of their own herds, when they reach sexual maturity as a young male, they will group together and form a group of bachelors that have a sort of a loose hierarchy. And they often spar with each other, fight with each other, to practice their techniques for the day when it will come time to compete for their own harem. These boys aren't there just yet. They are much, much smaller than the stallion we saw earlier. I think they need to learn to pick their battles, because they definitely weren't going to win that one. Oh, what a brilliant one. Thank you so much, Lou, for that reminder. I can't believe I didn't think of that first. In answer to Faith's question, and actually VM was on camera with me, The tortoise and the sticks, VM? You were on camera with me, yeah. We had an extraordinary sighting with the three sticks females before they had their cubs lying up on the southern boundary of Juma. And one very tiny, if I'm not mistaken, was a Speke's hinge tortoise that decided to go crawling right up to the lioness and ultimately ended up in an accidental cuddle. I don't know if it was seeking out warmth or if it just wasn't really concentrating on where it was going. But either way, the lioness was lying completely flat on her side. And this tortoise sort of came closer to her and she ended up putting her paw on top of it. And this little tortoise underneath. And lions do eat tortoises. They often harass tortoises. They've got jaw strength capable of breaking open a tortoise shell, especially a little one. So we're all sitting with bated breath waiting for this poor tortoise to get noticed and chomped. And it didn't. Eventually she rolled over onto the other side and the tortoise made a beeline and off it went into the bush. That was a truly odd encounter. That was one for the books. And then unexplained sightings of aggression. We were not too far from here. In fact, it was almost exactly here that female elephant knocked over a younger member of the herd. But that, I think, is relatively common. It was just that we couldn't really provide an explanation for what it was that had upset her in that situation. And then young animals. Young animals are often responsible for interesting and odd sightings. And I know that Brent's often told me stories of young Kunyuma doing strange things, and I'm sure he'd like to elaborate a little bit on that. Perhaps he's got more tales to tell you.
Oh, very much indeed. My strangest stories since being at Safari Live were with young Kunyuma. Kunyuma was a male leopard, one of Karula's last set of cubs that survived to adulthood. And he used to behave quite strangely, running up massive dead leadwood trees, nearly having the branches break under his weight and running down again. But still, I think the most odd thing I've ever experienced at Safari Live was when he went to go have a drink at Chele Pan. Sorry, I'm just double checking on these lion tracks. I think one lion might not have crossed, but what I think happened, what I know happened to Chele Pan is that there were two Dugga boys lying in the mud, and Kunyuma came for a drink and he snuck up on them, and the buffalo were just lying there minding their own business, chewing the cud. And he just walked up and went whack, smacked a buffalo on the bum for no apparent reason, jumped up a little jackalberry tree, and then proceeded, when the buffalo decided to try hook him with his horns, he just sat there going it was quite incredible. Now, just double checking that lion didn't stay in Juma. I don't know, we just found his tracks again now. I just want to have a quick look. There's a coming this way, so if he's crossed, he should have crossed around here somewhere. I didn't see any tracks. There he is. Okay. Oh, he did cross. Oh yeah. Well, I heard some elephants back down that way, so let's head there. And why not? Because we haven't for such a long time. Okay, well, we've got a question from Faith. I'm going to answer it in a second, Faith. Now, first, I'm going to drive Dave mad. Where did it go? Oh, you're lucky, Dave. You're very lucky. Maybe not. Okay, did you see that? Oh, no, it's too fast. Okay, I won't torture Dave with a tiny moth that's fluttering about. But okay, now I can torture Dave with a tiny moth that's fluttering about. There's quite a few of them, and their camouflage is actually, oh, darn it, incredible. Okay, I'm trying to just move very slowly. I'm going to pick up a piece of grass. You see the end of that grass. Ooh. Is this too close, Dave? Look there. Look at that. A grasshopper that looks like sand. So if you stop and look, there's always amazing things around. So look at that little grasshopper. It's same color as the soil here. It looks like these granite soils on the crest. Can you see him, Dave?
Yeah,
there we go. See, there he is. Hello. Up. Okay, now back to the moth. I don't know if this other plant is in the way. But do you see the end of my stick or my grass?
Yes.
Can you see the moth?
Yes.
Now look at that. That is incredible. Oh, look at all, he's coming to visit. No, it's gone away. So there was a broad-banded grass yellow, one of a very beautiful butterfly that came fluttering past. But look at that there. So that's incredible camouflage. It just looks like it's part of the plant. I don't even know what type of moth that is. But the real reason why I stopped here, and don't worry, Faith, I haven't forgot about you. I just quite like sitting in the sand. It's quite pleasant from sitting in the Land Rover. Good, clean African dirt. Now, what I actually stopped to get, just make sure there's nothing other, no other wonderful little creatures around. Okay, let's carry on. You know, it's not the healthiest looking one. It's called a string of stars. or a lamb's tail. Now, what is it? One of our more common flower species, especially on open areas or next to roads. And just click it back in. Now, it is a heliotrope. Now, helios is, of course, the sun. So a heliotrope is a sun follower. So what happens is, what these flowers do during the day, and they do it ever so slowly, as the sun moves, the whole plant will move to face the sun. Isn't that incredible? The heliotrope. These are quite old already. You can see some of them have already died. And it could be just from lack of water. I can still hear those elephants, so let's head in that direction. Now, Faith, you mentioned me, say a lodge. You mean I can come on a safari to these places? Yes, Faith, you can indeed. And there are multiple different lodges in this area that you can come on holiday to. There's Juma, where we live. They've got two lodges, Galago and Vuyotela. And, of course, Arethusa Safari Lodge, where we also drive, and Cheetah Plains, and a whole host of other ones. Cheetah Plains, where we were with that elephant, the lodge was right there. So the ladies who were setting up the breakfast table waved at me while we were sitting with that elephant. Okay, let's see. As Ellie sounded like they were just up ahead here. Hopefully they haven't moved off into these little riverine thickets to the north of us. It's quite warm already, Dave. What do you think? What temperature do you think it is? 26. 26? I think it might even be 29. 28. 28. Let's go. Safe bet. There we go, vital control there. So it's actually 27 and 80 Fahrenheit. So we're around there. But I mean, that's already at what? Not even 8:30 in the morning. Okay. Where did those elephants go? This is where I heard them. And there's tracks vanishing. Quick moving ellies, these ones. Obviously in a rush to get somewhere. Oh, there they are, disappearing. Oh, we're just a little bit too late. Oh, and they're just moving into those riverine thickets. I was hoping to catch them before they did. Now, hello, Steve. Steve is in Taiwan. And Steve is wondering, how do elephants get their salt intake in this area? Well, Steve, they will eat soil mostly, mud. And in certain areas they'll excavate that soil and eat it. And it's not only for salt, also for other minerals that they might be lacking in their diet. And you can actually see on seep lines and areas that are eroded and sodic sites, you can actually see the salt build up. I'll try to see if I can spot it, find a spot like that for you, Steve. And you can actually see the salt, you can taste it as well. It's incredible. This is that little river system the elephants are heading into. Lots of dips, and we're not really going to go bashing and crashing off there. But you see, the elephants quite like to put things across the road for us. That one's not so bad, we'll just hop. There we go, that one wasn't too bad. But if I remember correctly, there's one that we can't hop over, we have to drive around on this road. Now, I'm hoping we might get some more bird species before the end of the drive. Dave and I had a very brief visual of a Deirdre's cuckoo, but it was too quick for us. So hopefully we'll be able to find it again shortly. But while we continue our search for all the wonders that lie here on Juma, let's go see how Jamie's search is going.
Also searching for the wonders of Juma, and I have to say, Juma holds many, many zebra, is what I've learned at the moment. But for now, we'll stop and have a look at these male impala that are thinking about sparring with each other. Yes, no? Can see the wariness of their body language. The one closest to us approaching the second. Okay. Relaxed again. Hey boys, full of the joys of spring. I figured with the warm temperatures it might be worth coming and having a look at the mud wallows on Twin Dams. And I did see an elephant across the Mwati, so I'm hoping we might catch up with them there. Let's go on a little bit further and see if I can see that elephant again. Even now, early in the morning, for the elephants, it'll be a nice time to go and have a mud wallow. And I can see what these zebra have been shouting about. They're lots and lots of bachelor groups as we've been driving along Vulture's Nest Road. I've probably seen 40 zebra from Hyena Road to Vulture's Nest. That's about a kilometer stretch of road. Lots of them around. Right, where's this elephant? I know I saw one. And morning to Velma in Michigan. Good question that's come through from you, and I've been thinking the same thing. You're saying it seems as though we're seeing a lot of baby elephants. Is this unusual, or is it because they're coming in from Kruger because of the drought? And Velma, it's not unusual. This is the sort of, not prime breeding season, but it is a peak breeding season. But I think you are right in that it has to do with the drought. I think it's just a higher concentration of elephants. Since we've had more rain, they're coming to this area because it's greener and there's more food. So we're seeing more elephants and therefore we're seeing more babies. Oh look, zebra. You're not an elephant, but I swear I saw an elephant somewhere in here from the other side of the drainage line. There's another bachelor herd. Also having come in conflict with each other. They must have been responsible for the yipping that I heard earlier. Marching off away from Chelepan in single file. Can see an elephant. Oh, there's the elephant. So I didn't imagine it. I'm very glad to see that. I thought I was going slightly crazy. The zebra exceptionally unsettled. It's because the wind has picked up and they know how vulnerable they are around a waterhole. They have to put their heads down. So as a result, they always approach with great caution. Elephant? I see you. Don't you want to come and enjoy the water of Chelepan? Somebody else is. It's very common for us to encounter these big buffalo balls in the remaining muddy puddles. This is Chelepan. It's one of the biggest natural water holes that we have here. And there's always one or two resident dugger boys. Oh, look, somebody's still thirsty. Who wants to come for a drink? Ah, thank you. Good spot. I don't want to reposition because I know if I do, the zebra is going to get up and run away. One thing we would have been able to notice as he drinks is that he's got, all zebra have very, very dark noses. And Monkey Business, you wanted to know if zebra gets sunburnt noses. And the answer is no, not really. And the black around the nose, which is of course is a good question because that's where some of the most sensitive skin is, and particularly in equids. They've got very, very sensitive skin around their muzzles, around their snouts. So no, the black around the nose is one of the biggest protective features to help guard against sunburn. Generally, most of the animals are well protected against the harsh effects of the African sun, from the elephants with their dark grey skin that they very frequently cover in mud and sand to help just add to that protection. Oh, I love the trunk there at the back as well. Come on, Eddies, come have a drink and a bath quickly, just for the last few moments. Elephants are well protected. Most of the animals are well protected. It's one of the reasons why albinism, which you do see in certain species like elephants, albinism is very, very rare. And those animals that are born albino seldom survive to adulthood, and it's not a gene that is selected for. I've never heard of albino zebra, but I wouldn't be surprised if it does happen. See, they still, some of them still want to go and have a drink. You can see the unsettled body language, and there's clearly been plenty of aggression here between them, because whenever they walk in close proximity to each other, ears go flat, backwards. Those of you with horses will know immediately that that is generally a sign of an unhappy animal. Let's just watch for a second, because they're all gathered together here, and they seem to have reached a sort of a standoff, an uneasy truce. Ears constantly twitching backwards and forwards, listening to the sounds of the bush. And you can hear, well, I'm not sure if you can hear actually, you probably can't, the wind is now howling once again. It's a little bit like being in a hairdryer. Now, one of the reasons for these animals, this animal's caution in approaching the waterhole, is their natural instinct that... Sure, lots of zebra fighting going on. Their natural instinct that big bodies of water are to be feared and to be approached with a huge degree of caution. And that's because, yes, we could get crocodiles here. I haven't seen crocodiles since I started working on... No, that's not true. I did see some crocodiles at Sydney's Dam, tiny little ones. Apparently, crocodiles used to be a regular sighting, but of course, with the drought being what it is, those sightings are now relatively unusual. Most of the surviving crocodiles have moved off to the bigger bodies of water. But yes, we could get crocodiles here, and it's one of the reasons you'll find with all of us... any kind of body of water in the bush is to be approached with caution. You never know who might be lurking there. And a body of water that didn't hold a crocodile one day, you can come back the next day and all of a sudden there is one. That being said, it would take quite a large crocodile to catch a zebra of this size. And this body of water is not really large enough to support a massive Nile crocodile. It would take one at least, I would say, at least 2 to 3 meters long to be able to catch a zebra. But if you go further to the south, if you go towards the Sand and the Sabi rivers, there are absolutely crocodiles. You'll see plenty of them if you ever find yourself visiting the Kruger National Park. That is an animal that I'm still waiting to properly have a sighting of. Right, I'm going to move off, I think, since our elephants are playing hard to get. Let's head across to Brent and find out what his plans are for the last few moments of our sunrise safari.
As always, I'm the eternal optimist, so I'm checking our southern firebreak for any signs of Queen Karula. And fingers crossed, you never know what could be around the next corner. And of course, I'm still in search of all the new migratory birds that have arrived in the last while. So far, we've got to see Malacca cuckoo, African cuckoo, European beater today, that was a good one. Broad-billed roller, that was the best one. Dave, your aerial is monk. And what else? I'm trying to remember now. We've heard quite a few other cuckoos, and I'm hoping to find some of them for you, but as the wind picks up, it does make the birding a little bit more difficult. So, who knows? We'll have to try on the sunset safari. Remember, there is a fireside chat tonight. And the topic is the Birmingham boys. Pity we didn't see any this morning, but we heard them. Why, the impala believed me. They thought, why, where's that lion? My goodness. Yeah, see, the impala believed me. For once, an animal believed my lion roar. Mm. 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 And of course, for those of you who don't speak lion, what the lion is actually saying is, whose land is it? Whose land is it? Whose land is it? It's mine. It's mine. It's mine. That was taught to me by my father and grandfather as a small child to understand what lions were saying. Of course, there's different variations, but we can't get too into lion talk for now. Ellie says she's got a very important question that only I can answer, and she would like to know, how does one grow such glorious hair? I don't know. Probably you just add some good old African dirt into it, some African sunshine, and let it be. That's the only thing I can think. Now, of course, since we are talking about the Birmingham boys this evening, I think my mane is more impressive than theirs, but we'll have to see. We can discuss that later on the fireside chat, whose mane is more impressive, 1-4 Birmingham or Birmingham or actually I was trying to think, or Brent or the bee. I'm just the bee. You got the Birminghams, I'm just the bee. We're all maned, and I think my mane's more magnificent. But enough of this nonsense. Let's go to Jamie so she can say goodbye. We'll see you on the Sunset Safari.
Well, certainly Brent's sports an impressive head of hair, perhaps even to rival the Birmingham boys. His beard, on the other hand, well, I think that the Birmingham boys definitely win that particular context. But don't tell him I said that. Kirsten, don't tell him I said that. And so, on that note, while we practice our arguments for tonight's fireside chat, we're slowly meandering our way back home. It's breakfast time and time for meetings and all sorts of things. And for the last few minutes, I was going to try and show you what I thought was a cuckoo, but it turned out to be a very rapidly moving swallow. That's definitely not going to work. For the last few minutes, let's see what exciting things we can find. Oh, there's something very large. What a nice way to end. Finish off the sunrise safari in the same way we started it. Possibly even with the same herd of elephants that we started it with. Now, Honey's Ocelot. Speaking of elephants, the last question for the Sunrise Safari, you want to know if elephants sneeze. And I've never seen an elephant sneeze. I actually don't think that they can with their trunk set up. They can snort and blow, because obviously they do get stuff stuck up their trunks, bits of dust and all sorts of things. So they will blow air out of their trunks, but I have never seen an elephant sneeze. And as far as I know, I don't think they can. I've also never seen an elephant yawn. Again, I think with their trunk and nasal structure, it's a little bit tricky. It's amazing the strange things that you learn working out here and just sitting and observing the animals. They don't sneeze and they don't yawn. And as far as I know, they also don't vomit. I remember having this discussion with one of our viewers many, many months ago. Oh, here we go. Massive herd of elephants gathering and moving past. We'll have to wait for them before we start our race off towards the breakfast table. I hope you're all excited about the fireside chat this evening and that you've sent through all of your questions in advance. We look forward to seeing you all then. And unfortunately, as we end off with a beautiful elephant sighting, it is a time for us to say farewell. So a big thank you to Viam for his wonderful camera work, as well as to Kirst and I think to Lou and D2. Kirst, who's your D2? I'm not 100% sure who the D2 is today. It is Lou. It is Lou. So there we go. Big thank you to Kirsten Lou in Final Control, as well as to our tech team on the ground, which at the moment is just Alex. And most importantly, a big thank you to all of you watching across the globe. I hope you had a marvelous time and that we will catch up with you on the Sunset Safari this evening. I think we should finish off with a look at these beautiful elephants as they stream across the road in front of us. How very beautiful. Bye-bye, everyone.